Please welcome, if you would, from Nebraska, or from Oklahoma, but give him a welcome from Nebraska, Pastor Paul Blair.
How many of you are Cornhusker fans? Let me share with you some good information. Oklahoma State 38, Oklahoma 35 in overtime today. Isn't that great? Wonderful. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege to be here. Thank you for coming out on a Saturday evening. But as I said today, Nebraska's not playing, so where else should you be or could you be? What a great event. 6,000 years of human history. Totalitarianism, tyranny, has been the default form of human government. But we have this thing that we refer to as American exceptionalism. Well, why is America different? Why have we been different? Well, ladies and gentlemen, you look at two foundation stones in our Declaration of Independence, which was our nation's birth certificate. By the way, this was an action where Thomas Jefferson was given the privilege of penning our secession from a tyrannical government. We were cutting out from England. When in the course of human events it becomes necessary to dissolve the political bands which have joined you to another, to assume among the powers of the earth a separate equal station to which the laws of gate nature and nature's God entitle you. Wow, this was a tremendous move that they were making. And there are two pillars that this new experiment in government was built upon. First of all, God. God grants unalienable rights, not government. The government's sole purpose is to secure and defend our rights. And then there is a standard of truth. Truth is not arbitrary. It's not up to a vote of the majority of the people. Our founding fathers believed that natural law could not be disagreed with. If God had spoken, then man couldn't disagree with it. If God hadn't spoken on an area, then man was free to legislate in that particular area. And as such, we have been given this incredible union of 50 states, which together, via a compact in 1787, created a small, limited general government, delegating certain few and defined responsibilities to this civil body politic that now resides in Washington, D.C. Let me ask you a question. How many of you think that they think their powers are still few and defined? Seems that they think they have unlimited power these days. But understand that the traditional, the typical, the default form of government is tyranny. And in order for tyranny to rule, then government must become God. God can't be God. Government must become God. Now, in America, that was unique because our unalienable rights come to us from our Creator. But in any tyrannical government, that can't be so. The government must become God. So either you have an atheistic communism, as they have in Red China, the former Soviet Union, where there is no God. So by default, where must rights come from? The rights must come from God, or from government, because that's all that's left. Or you have a theocracy, as they have in Saudi, as they have in Iran, as England was with King James when our pilgrim forefathers first came to America for civil and religious liberty. But in that case, as well, government and God become one and the same, inseparable. And there is no freedom of religion. There can be no freedom of conscience because you can't have the ability to disagree with government. Government has become God. Does that make sense? Well, in America, we have not faced that. We have been blessed immeasurably because we have the ability to worship or not to worship in this country. One of the things that is troubling about the Muslim Brotherhood, the North American Islamic Trust, the Islamic Society of North America, and all this laundry list of alphabet soup agencies is that we discovered in an arrest in 2004 their agenda for North America. Now, that's not Zudi Jasser, by the way. Zudi is a friend. But this group that represents a significant, at least by appearance, a significant representation of Islam has dedicated themselves to settle North America and ultimately overthrow the constitutional republic that we have and establish a Sharia law and integrate us into a global caliphate. Now, I've got a problem with that, and I would imagine that you should too. Now, as Americans, we are going to have disagreements. And we have the freedom to worship, and we can still be good neighbors, and we can dialogue, which is what we have done all day today. We have had a wonderful time being able to challenge each other with questions and the like. We've had really had some good fellowship today. However, the two biggest questions that I have to see addressed as a Christian is, number one, who is Jesus? And number two, why was the tomb empty? Now, as my friends, the rabbi and the Muslim over here to my right, neither one of them recognized that Jesus is the Messiah or the Son of God, and neither one recognized that Jesus rose from the dead. Now, I can't make them believe that. As a Christian, it's my responsibility to share the good news with every creature, but I can't make them believe that. Nevertheless, we can be good neighbors and live side by side with each other. We can be great friends. We can help each other in every way, but we can't worship together because we have fundamental disagreements. You understand where I'm going? So I personally am concerned about this idea of this tri-faith center downtown. We can be good neighbors, we can live next door to each other, we can be friends, we can be Americans, but we cannot, in fact, co-worship because we disagree on those very fundamental issues. Thank you very much.
All right, well, I think we gained a little bit of time. Dr. Jesser, please.
I'm not as vertically blessed as Pastor Blair, but hopefully vocally I will be. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting us, and Vicki and Mark and the other Mark and all of you for having us here. Time being short, I'm going to cut to why I'm here. Before I tell you who I am, let me tell you why I'm here. I know the title this afternoon was Building Bridges for Peace, and ultimately I want to share with you what's been my lifetime dedication about how to do interfaith work and how to do it right. I know that in the opening he mentioned the Tri-Faith Initiative. I really am now just getting to know about it. My comments don't refer to that initiative. I think I'll leave it to you. Those of you in Omaha, I've not met anyone in that initiative really other than read about it. So I'll leave it to you to interpolate or understand how to translate a lot of those things into those. But I will tell you that interfaith work is at the head of the spear. And it's important about how we do things locally and yet think globally. It has impact. And I think ultimately, and as much as I mentioned that my comments, you know, I've not met anyone with Tri-Faith Initiative, also I can tell you that as close as I am to Mark and all of your work, there's a good deal of information back there that Mark has written that I would disagree with, that I would find a lot of problems with as a Muslim. But that's the beauty of America. When I served in the Navy, I was telling my friends about a Bible, Christian, Quranic, Old Testament, Talmudic study that we had on the ship that included a Mormon, a Baptist, a Catholic, a Jew, and a Muslim that we did every week on the USS El Paso. So this was something that we enjoyed doing. We disagreed about pathways to God. We felt it was the same God. But ultimately, when it came to fighting for America, protecting our country, and national security, the reason my family came here from Syria was we felt we could practice our faith more freely in America than anywhere in the world. And we were part of families that came here because we felt the West had a gem within it, which was liberty, that we wanted to understand and bring into reform. I know he mentioned in the intro reform Islam. I guess, yes, reform against the Islam of bin Laden, the Islam of the Brotherhood, the Islam of theocrats, yes. My Islam, you know, I feel I want to get back to the fundamentals, no different than Christians want to get back to the fundamentals of Jesus and have felt that it took many, many centuries of theocracy and other things done in the name of Christianity before a country as great as America was created. And I think this is so important when you do interfaith work, to understand the lens that you bring to look at the faiths. If simply you want to get together and talk about commonalities, like you do in when you visit someone's home and you want to be hospitable and share a conversation, that's great. If you want to move the needle to make America stronger and figure out how diverse communities, diverse faiths can find what it is about our social contract in America that keeps us strong, that makes us want to fight together, because at the end of the day, the battle globally is between, within the House of Islam, it's between revivalists that want to go back to the old way and don't want any reform versus reformists that want to modernize. But globally, it's between what I would call Islamo-patriots, those that believe in jihad and the Islamic State, that they would die for the Islamic State, versus Muslims that would die for the secular, liberal, Western state. There's no in-between. And I can tell you, in Muslims that I know, we want nothing to do with the Islamic State. Our families came here to get away from not only ISIS, but all Islamic states. Because we understand in reading Western history that any theocracy, any state in which religion and government are mixed, as Pastor Blair so eloquently enunciated our founding principles in America, all theocracies are doomed to failure, no matter whether they're democratically elected. I mean, Hitler was democratically elected. So democracy is a tyranny of the majority, as our founding fathers have said. So we are a republic, we're not a democracy, because you can only protect minorities and individuals to worship God as they see fit when you have a republic that is based in the rule of law. The Supreme Court has the last word, not the majority. And I think that's a very important aspect that we need to bring into our understanding of modern Islam. And I think as a principle that Muslims can understand. For anyone who feels that, you know, Islam is doomed to tyranny, is doomed to theocracy, I'd remind you that Christianity took 1789 years till it had a constitution that affirmed render unto Caesar what is Caesar, unto God what is God's. But also with that, we then needed a civil war, we needed a civil rights movement to still remember what are some of our principles of equality and other aspects of our values. So the reason I'm here is hopefully bring to you a voice, not only of moderation, but to tell you that the problem within the House of Islam is not of violence and terrorism. That's a symptom. And if that's where the narrative is going locally or anywhere, you're not going to solve the problem. The deeper diagnosis is a much bigger problem, where you're talking 30-40% of the Muslim world that feels that political Islam and the Islamic State, while it may not be right today, could exist in the future. And we, as a community, as an organization, the American Islamic Forum, reject that. And I would tell you to remember Paine's word, Thomas Paine, who said, of all the tyrannies that affect mankind, the tyranny of religion is the worst. And that's the lens that I hope we can do interfaith work with, but also realizing that I hope I come here to tell you that sometimes both sides in America are wrong. Those who say Muslims are only of peace, and those who say that every Muslim is a possible terrorist and Islam is doomed in its recipe. I would tell you, and I've testified to Congress many times, both sides are wrong, and there are Muslims that are down the middle of liberty. Thank you.
And next, Rabbi Daniel. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Alaikum salam. I wanted to share with you a little bit of my personal biography. I thought it might be interesting. So I was born privileged to America's best gifts in public school education and in society. I was born in a very small southern town of Miami Beach. And I was able to finish high school, go to college, and after college, or during college, I switched from what I thought I was supposed to be, a lawyer, and I realized that maybe the world didn't need another Jewish lawyer. And I had become involved in the study of religion in a number of ways. The dean of the theology school where I went was dying, and she changed her curriculum that year and helped me understand the paper that I wrote as my thesis, Believing Despite. And for Jewish people to believe despite history, despite the suffering, despite the Holocaust, became a very significant element in my own identity formation. So I decided I should be a rabbi, because there they pay you to talk. What a good thing. I thought they paid you by the word, but it's not true. But I knew that if I were going to do this, I should head to Jerusalem, where I stayed for 5 years. I married a woman from the south side of Chicago I had met in Israel, and our first child was born in Jerusalem. I came back to America, and we lived in Illinois for close to 40 years. And we started my first Jewish Christian dialogue, to my surprise. I thought my obligations were, you know, my little tiny congregation to try and do the best job of teaching the tradition as I understood it and to pass it forward. But in fact, I came to discover that reaching outside the congregational walls were very important. If we are to redeem this world, we can no longer be an island unto ourselves. But we have to understand that our shared existence depends upon our mutual respect and cooperation. So I got involved in Jewish-Christian dialogue. Eventually, I became interreligious affairs chair for the American Jewish Committee. I became president of the Chicago Board of Rabbis. I became appointed to the Council of Religious Leaders of Metropolitan Chicago, where we were able to once and for all eliminate capital punishment in the state of Illinois. But we also did some other things. I started a Jewish learning club at the public high school because I thought that was the avenue where we could reach the most impact. And a number of years later, I started the Muslim learning club at that high school. And at one point, we had the Muslim kids go to the Jewish club's meeting. We had the Jewish kids go to the Muslim club meeting. They met for 5 months. Every year, we did a diversity week that was very strong. There are 27,000 high schools in the United States that have a diversity week. And they don't necessarily know what they're doing. But we were able to cull together good energies. And so at one point I was building my very great synagogue, I was very happy. Turns out raising money for a congregation is very difficult to do. But we gathered a whole bunch of money and we went through this zoning process that was unbelievable. It was curious, because the local Village Presbyterian Church also had about a similar size project. They had raised about a similar amount of money, but their zoning process was done in 6-7 weeks. Our congregation was subject to zoning and planning and staffing for 3 years. Now, there was a little bit of some prejudice involved in that. But from that, of course, my own allies, especially in the Greek Orthodox Church, Catholic Archdiocese of Chicago, and a number of other friends from the local clergy association, we were able to prevail on a number of fronts. But during that first year, when we were under construction and we had no place to worship on the high holidays, I approached the mosque in my community. They gave me the key and left. And we were able to forge an example and a relationship that lasted for years. And we're able to gather together good talking of members and stuff like that. The interconnectivity of community building and relationships is key. And if this effort here in Omaha, one of my favorite cities in the universe, is to be successful, it must have the interconnectivity between all peoples in good common dignity and respect if this project is to go forward to uplift the human spirit. Thank you.
And batting cleanup, Dr. Kirby.
The question on our mind here is Islam a viable partner for interfaith dialogue? What is a viable partner? simply somebody who's capable of working as a partner. Working for what? Interfaith dialogue. Here's a couple of components of interfaith dialogue involving the Tri-Faith Institute that we can refer to. Accepting each other's religious expression brings us together as a community. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are committed to promote mutual respect. So the question becomes, does Islam create a sense of coming together as a community? And does it promote mutual respect for Judaism and Christianity? Let's look at what Islam teaches. We'll start off with the Quran. Muslims believe the Quran is a timeless, perfect, and unchangeable word of Allah. So what does Allah have to say? He says the only religion acceptable to him is Islam. Islam is to be made superior over all other religions, even if the non-Muslims don't like it. Allah curses the Jews and Christians. Allah says the Jews are among the worst enemies of Islam, and says the Jews and Christians are among the worst of creatures. Allah forbids Muslims from being friends with Jews and Christians, and in fact, Allah commands Muslims to fight Jews and Christians until the Jews and Christians pay the jizya, which is a protection tax, with willing submission and feeling subdued. Allah says Jesus was not crucified, but it just appeared that way. What happened was Allah took Jesus bodily up into heaven, made one of Jesus' disciples look like Jesus, and that disciple was crucified. So Muslims who know their religion look at a crucifix or a painting of the crucifixion and see an imposter hanging on the cross. No crucifixion means no resurrection, which means Islam teaches that Christianity is based on a fraud. By believing that Jesus is the Son of God, Christians commit the one unforgivable sin in Islam, shirk. And for that, Christians will go to hell. What about Muhammad? Islam teaches that Muhammad spoke for Allah, and Allah commands Muslims to obey Muhammad. Chapter 33, verse 21 of the Quran says Muhammad is a timeless standard of conduct for Muslims. Muhammad said Jews and Christians are worth only half as much as a Muslim. Muhammad said the hour will not be established until you fight against the Jews. And the stone behind which a Jew will be hiding will say, O Muslim, there is a Jew hiding behind me, kill him. Muhammad said the Jews were grave robbers. And he said on the day of resurrection, mountains of sins would be removed from the backs of Muslims and put onto the backs of Jews and Christians. In fact, Muhammad said Jews and Christians would take the place of Muslims in hell. And on his deathbed, Muhammad said, I will expel the Jews and Christians from the Arabian Peninsula and will not leave any but Muslims. So how can Muslims be viable partners in an interfaith dialogue with commands and statements like these? Remember, these are timeless commands and statements from Allah and Muhammad, and Muslims are not allowed to disagree with these. So what's a Muslim to do? One option is to deny verses of the Quran. But Muhammad said, whoever denies a verse of the Quran, it is permissible to strike his neck, meaning execute him. Another option is for Muslims to provide their own personal interpretation or reinterpretation of verses from the Quran. Muhammad warned against this. Muhammad said, whoever explains the Quran with his opinion or with what he has no knowledge of, then let him assume his seat in the fire. That's the fire of hell. So how can Muslims even be friends with Jews and Christians? The answer is in chapter 3, verse 28 of the Quran. This specific verse allows Muslims to pretend to be friends with Jews and Christians if the Muslims are in fear of the Jews and Christians. So if a Muslim is to engage in an interfaith dialogue where, as the Tri-Faith Initiative here in Omaha says, there is an acceptance of each other's religious expression, promotion of mutual respect, and a coming together as a community, the Muslim has one of two choices. Ignore the teachings of Allah and Muhammad, or follow those teachings and simply pretend to be friends with Jews and Christians. Either way you look at it, Islam is not a viable partner for an interfaith dialogue. Thank you.
All right, that concludes the round of 6 minutes opening presentations. Now we're going to move to the 2-minute section. And just again to remind you, We'll start with Pastor Paul Blair first. He will have 2 minutes. Now, you can take the microphone here, or what we thought is we can just pass it around since we're maybe, but you're welcome to come up if you want to come up. Here, I'm going to give you the microphone and you can do whatever. And understand now, Pastor Blair has the opportunity to have a monologue or he can ask a question of one of the panelists. Okay, 2 minutes.
Let me begin by repeating the score 38 to 35. Well, my question will be for Zudi, and only for this reason. Quite frankly, everybody developed an interest in Islam on 9/11. Why? Because we had 19 Wahhabi Muslims crying out Allahu Akbar as they're flying airplanes into American office buildings. And the question is, what is Islam all about? Now, I've read Zudi's book, I've had a chance to visit with him. Zudi, I believe, genuinely in his heart, does not accept the unity of mosque and state. I don't believe he's deceiving him. Maybe he is. Maybe he's real good at it. But I believe he's genuine where he wants to separate that concept. However, knowing that Muhammad, as Stephen said, Muhammad is the ideal Muslim. And that would be first question number one for Zudi here in a second. Is Muhammad the ideal? Is his life to be followed as a pattern? And then secondly, how can you separate the Medina verses, or Medina verses? You know, Mecca, it was a religion. After 13 years, had less than 150 followers. Then goes to Medina, it turns into a political system, and from that point on, averaged roughly 10,000 new converts a year through conquest and intimidation. So Muhammad failed as a religious leader, but he succeeded as a political leader. Yet, you want to separate the two. How can you do that with what you're trying to do? That's it? Well, you're the one that made up these. Who votes that we change the rules? Okay, great.
What if I want to answer something? We talked about rebutting comments made during the speeches.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, we hadn't really anticipated that maybe you would be picked on.
Yeah. You hadn't anticipated a six-piece Orientalist review of an entire condemnation of the faith of Islam?
So,
I mean, that needs a three-hour response.
Where would you like to?
I'd like to respond in Arctic Kirby, and then I'll respond too.
Okay, so let's go 4 minutes.
Okay, let me do 2 minutes on Arctic Kirby, and then I'll respond to the kinder comments from Pastor Paul. Yes, 2 minutes. So first let me say that I think Dr. Kirby, with all due respect, exemplified how not to do interfaith dialogue. Why? Number one, I didn't hear one quotation. When you want to talk about specifics, he anthropomorphized Islam and spoke as if God was speaking to me to tell me what Islam is, as if he was speaking through the words of God. If he is not God, which he is not, none of us are, thank God, he would be quoting a Muslim. If he's quoting a Muslim, he said he was quoting the Prophet Muhammad. We don't believe any of the words of the Prophet Muhammad were written for hundreds of years till after his death. So therefore, those are hadith spoken by the Prophet that were written down by some verified source, Sahih Bukhari, some version of hadith. We can then take those words. He mentioned, kill a Jew behind every stone. It's in the Hamas charter. I believe as a Muslim, many Muslims, most I would tell you have rejected that, said the Prophet never said it, number one. Number two, a lot of what he described as Muslims, which is, you either say it in Arabic, which is Muslim, or Muslim if you're going to use the Western. But anyway, Muslims believe in the faith of Islam. If you want to cite a Muslim, you can, but to generalize about an entire faith prevents us Muslims from having reformists that can speak on the behalf of liberty, on the behalf of America, and ideas that can counter and reform the ideas he was talking about. And then to say that somehow the Prophet Muhammad advocated lying is a misinterpretation. We can talk about that passage. I was not raised to lie about anything. You can look at my record publicly the last 30, 40 years, and other Muslims, they should be held accountable. That's good interfaith work. And if you want to cite Muslims that have said one thing in one place and then show how they say something and sometimes in other languages differently, that's corruption, that's dishonesty. But we see that as describing as dishonesty, not as Islam, because otherwise it becomes a deception, not a religion.
Okay, now we're going to move into
So the pastor asked a question, is that do we as Muslims believe that the Prophet Muhammad was an example for us to follow? Absolutely. I mean, we would not believe that the Prophet was chosen as the messenger of the Word of God unless he was an exemplary human being. The Quran itself has many passages that correct the Prophet because he made errors. And it would not be true unless he was human, unless he would make errors and he was corrected on those behalfs. Now, if you want to talk about certain sirah or examples or stories of the Prophet that appear to be immoral to some people or corrupt, we can talk about which narrative we as Muslims believe. But if you want to work on the side of reformists, the reformist narrative is one in which we discard narratives that you may call it all of it mythology, because if you're not a Muslim, you're going to think all Islam is mythology. So I would say that you should work with Muslims that have narratives of the Prophet's stories that are compatible with Western ideology. Now, if you think none of it is, then you need to say that we have a mission to convert a quarter of the world's population. If you don't want to convert Muslims, and then you need to work with those that can contextualize the actions of the Prophet in a way that's moral for 620 AD. If the Prophet said, kill the infidels where you find them, and was related to a battle, why is that any different than General Petraeus in Iraq telling our soldiers to kill the militants or in Afghanistan, kill the Taliban where you find them? That was a battle in one time. The Wahhabis, which is the voice that Dr. Kirby was using as his own of Islam, the Wahhabis, the Islamists, do have this supremacist mindset. But most Muslims, I think, who have been silent, need to be woken up, would speak against that. So the example of the Prophet Muhammad is not, I believe reformists would tell you, what would the Prophet do today if he were alive? The revivalists want to say, let's take it back exactly what he did at that time and not reform and keep it frozen in time without any modernization and reform.
So I'm going to end up with a question, but I think I'll start off with a statement. After 9/11, all of the cooperations that existed in Chicago, anyhow, fell apart interreligiously. And so along with the cooperation of His Eminence Cardinal George and a number of Muslim educators, we organized the Chicago Coalition for Interreligious Learning. And throughout that process of organizing curricula to teach about the other, we discovered there were two principles. One is that each of us should self-identify, should tell you what our religion stands for. So if you're going to learn about Judaism, frankly, don't express your opinions. Get somebody who knows what they're talking about and have them talk about Judaism. I'd be happy to come back anytime you want. But the second thing is to describe, how does your faith encourage us to treat other people? And on what basis, on what of your own faith, of your own religion, encourages you to get along with everybody in the world? Now, I will tell you, my basis for that is a little different than others. I know many people think love your neighbor as yourself is the sine qua non of why we should get along in the world. But the original source in the Bible was really limited to being extra specially nice to other Jewish people. But the fact that God created all of us, every human being in God's own image, allows us the commandment, the obligation to love every human being. And what I would ask of the pastor and of Dr. Jesser, in what way does your faith command you to reach out to all other humans?
I think what we'll do in this situation, your question was directed at? Pastor. Okay. We'll give you 30 seconds.
Well, Christianity says to love your neighbor as yourself. So as a follower of Christ, if I have a neighbor in need, I want to do the best I can to try to assist him in any logical, reasonable way that I can. Obviously, that's where charity comes in. You know, in a biblical worldview, there are different realms of responsibility. You know, there's self-government, there's church government, there's family government, and then there's civil government. And a lot of times in America these days, we have had the civil government overgrowing what it's supposed to be doing and infringing on what we're supposed to be doing in regards to self-government. Am I done already? Really? Okay, so charity is not the act of the civil government, that's the responsibility of the individual. So that is something that God has placed upon me. I want to share my faith with others, and I also want to demonstrate my love to one another. But at the same time, I'm not a fool. I'm going to have my alarm on at the house, and I'm a concealed carry guy. If somebody breaks into my home, I'm not going to pray for them. I'm going to protect my wife and shoot them. So, amen.
Yeah, I think that's a great question, because the divide again between reformists and revivalists are, I think there's very little in the Quran. I mean, obviously there's a lot in the Quran about just war and battles and fighting, you know, because of the battles that occurred in Arabia. But as far as missionary work, there's one passage, it's called to al-amr bil-ma'ruf wa nahy munkar, which means to enjoin what is good and forbid what is evil. There are the Islamists that believe you do that evangelically by doing what they call da'wah or education about Islam. And I was raised in the fact that human beings today in a very sophisticated, educated society and world have learned by example. They don't learn by intimidation, they don't learn by coercion, and it doesn't work. I was taught that the way to enjoin good is to live a humble life of humility and teach people what his goodness is. And then ultimately they will ask questions and want to emulate that. If you push it and coerce it, it will not work. That's the Islam I was taught. Obviously, as I'm sure Dr. Kirby would love to tell you, there are other forms of Islam out there that we need to reform and counter, but that is not the only version of Islam, which currently is the militant Islamic State version, which is coercive and oppressively missionary in its nature.
All right, in terms of Sahih al-Bukhari, for 1,100 years, Sahih al-Bukhari has been considered the most reliable collection of hadiths, the teachings and examples of Muhammad. Dr. Jasser disagrees with that. He is disagreeing with 1,100 years of Islamic scholarship. I would be curious down the road if at some point he'd explain the basis for his disagreement. But until that point, there are 6 authoritative collections of hadiths that have been authoritative for about 1,100 years. If an individual Muslim disagrees with those, the burden is on the individual Muslim to show why and the doctrinal basis for disagreeing. Dr. Jasser mentioned I was quoting Allah. Actually, no, I was just paraphrasing what the verses of the Quran say. If the verses of the Quran consist of the speech of Allah, the commands of Allah, then I'm paraphrasing what Allah had to say. And to make sure that I understood these verses I've referred to, I consulted 7 different translations of the Quran, each translation done by one or more Islamic scholars, Muslim scholars. I've referred to 5 different authoritative Quran commentaries. The commentaries explain what the verses of the Quran mean. They rely on the hadiths, which Dr. Jasser raises questions about. So basically, when I talk about what a verse of the Quran says, it's not what Steve Kirby says. It's what Muslim scholars say the verse means, and some of them are pretty self-evident, like 582. It flat out says, Jews are among the worst enemies of Islam. There's no ifs, ands, or buts, or ambiguity about that. So I would say, if you're going to question the verse of the Quran, first consult the tafsirs, consult the various Quran translations to make sure you understand what they're saying, and then if you disagree with it, you come up with your doctrinal basis for disagreement, write a Quran commentary, and bring it up for scholarly examination and have people ask you questions about it.
My name is Mark Christian. I'm from Global Faith Institute. I was just going to interrupt for you very quickly. What you are saying, Dr. Steve, has so much validity into the Islamic teachings for many, many years. But I would have to disagree with you in one thing. You mentioned Sahih Bukhari. For many years, we didn't have brave men like Dr. Zudi Jasser to come out and not only disagree in his heart, like many Muslims are, but he stood up against the tyranny of Islam and opposed it. As a matter of fact, in the last month and a half. There is two imams from Al-Azhar University. If you don't know, Al-Azhar University is the only legitimate university in the world in Islamic teachings. Every imam has to get his degree to preach Islam. Two imams start challenging Sahih Bukhari altogether. And as soon as they did that, there is a whole bunch of debate going on in Al-Azhar and in Egypt and in the Middle East, all over the media, and I've been following it closely. So I would agree with what you're saying, but we have to stand with people like Zuhdi Jasser and those two imams, but we don't have those imams in the United States. We have Dr. Zuhdi Jasser in the United States. We have his organization. I would stand firmly next to him because he's the only one and his organization is giving me hope that there is no Islamist will kill me one day in the streets of the United States or kill my son because we're apostates of Islam. So thank you.
Let me respond to that. Yeah, I understand what you're talking about, and I encourage the two imams. But the bottom line is, this is a relatively recent debate going up against 1,100 years of Islamic scholarship. I'm all for that. All I'm asking is, provide some doctrinal basis for disagreement. Dr. Jasser just said he disagrees with Sahih al-Bukhari. Wonderful. You have to have more than just disagreeing to counter 1,100 years of Islamic scholarship. So right now the burden of proof in terms of discounting Bukhari is on the two imams and Dr. Jasser. And if all they have to go on is a personal opinion, that doesn't carry any weight. As much as we wish it would, it doesn't carry any weight against 1,100 years of Islamic scholarship.
I reject the premise of your response, Dr. Kirby, because on the one hand, you dismiss my ability to refute translations, which I believe you're still providing translations, that in my book I talk about how you can take the same Arabic and give it a completely different meaning if you do it from a moderate perspective. The bottom line is the internet and global Islam is soaked with Wahhabi petrodollar billion dollars of translations that dominate our mosque and our Islamic community, because the liberty-minded, reform-minded have not been fueled, have not had the same energy, do not have dictatorships and dictatorships after one after the other, country after country, fueling radical Islam to maintain their power structure. So just like if I was a Christian in 1750 AD or CE, and I try to tell you that Christianity is the Church of England, Common Era, sorry. If I was trying to tell you in 1750 that Christianity is what the Church of England says, you have no scholarship, you can't define it based on reason, the laity can't define these things, etc., etc., how is that any different? And he keeps telling me that I'm not quoting sources, and yet he can say something in 10 seconds and say that's authoritative, when in fact, if we had the time, I could sit and read this verse he just quoted. I looked up, by the way. It doesn't say in the translation I use, don't take Jews as friends. It says, you will have animosity with their interpretations of their faith. So it depends which translations. It's true, we do have disagreements with the Jews on certain issues. And chapter 5 is very controversial about those things, and in my book, I address that and address chapter 9 also, which has significant passages, but you can't do this willy-nilly. It can't be done, oh, he gets 20 seconds to condemn all of our beliefs, and then I'm supposed to somehow respond in an academic, sourced way. These sources exist. Dr. Naim at Emory University did a whole book on Islam and the secular state. Dr. Al-Ashmawi in Egypt was put in prison because of his book on the separation of mosque and state, and he did these from a position in the Supreme Court of Sharia in Egypt. So these scholars exist, but we can't just say, well, and he was saying that he doesn't speak for Islam, yet he says things as if God was speaking to me, telling me what Islam is versus reason.
All right, now we're gonna go back in sequence. Okay, all right. And, Pastor,
I really don't want this to be pick on Zuhdi, but I'm sorry, Zuhdi, it's pick on Zuhdi night. And the reason being is this, that there's not a group of Jews saying we want to overthrow the United States of America and replace it with the Torah, and there's not Christians saying we want to overthrow. We do have those that were identified by the Muslim Brotherhood and the Holy Land Foundation trials that are on record for saying that that's what their intent is. So unfortunately, that's why you're getting picked on. Dr. Kirby made a couple of factual statements, 1,400 years of history and the evidence of 57 Islamic states. And you have referenced the fact that you believe that the Prophet, if he was alive today, would do such a thing. And I believe that you genuinely believe that. I don't think that you're being dishonest in that. However, there are 57 Islamic states that interpret it differently than what you do. There's 1,400 years of history going all the way back to Muhammad's conquest of the Arabian Peninsula, just a handful of years. You've got Omar's conquest of North Africa and the Holy Land and all up into Persia. You've got the Surah 8, which says, fight them until there is no more unbelief and the religion will be for Allah alone. I don't know how to reinterpret that in light of what we have seen in 1,400 years of history and what's going on in 57 Islamic states. So let me ask you this. How do we help you get your version of Islam, which you're sharing with us tonight, to be accepted by the other 57 Islamic states and to reject what they've done for 1,400 years?
I don't disagree with anything Pastor Paul just told you. This is a huge problem. We have a major leadership problem. There are no Muslim majority countries that are democracies or even have gone through an enlightenment. I could give you some reasons that this radical Islam, political Islam, has thrived. Illiteracy rates over 50% for men, over 80% for women. But those are excuses. I still think the bottom line is that you have societies. 1 year of an open society in Egypt did more to destroy the ideas of Al-Azhar and political Islam than 60 years of tyranny under Nasser, Sadat, Mubarak, and dictatorship. So if you want to defeat bad ideas, you do it with good ideas and opening of society. You don't push them underground because that creates and fuels political Islam. So how you help me? You give us platforms in which let the Muslim Brotherhood have their voice, but recognize that they're not the only voice in Muslims. Insist whenever there's a voice on CNN, on MSNBC, in Congress, in universities, in local churches, in synagogues, when there's the Muslim Brotherhood represented, bring other Muslims that are reform-minded to see us debate about what these passages mean. And there are some core ideas. What is their belief of the Ummah? Is the Ummah just a faith community or is it a state? If it's a state, they're not modern, you don't want to work with them. Caliphate, will they reject the caliphate? Major question. Jihad, I reject jihad completely. I'm not going to give you an apologetic. There's no way to apologize for jihad other than, yes, it is a struggle. I have friends, their first name is jihad, so I understand that it's not always holy war. But we have to reject the doctrine of war and jihad, and that's tied to the Islamic State. Blasphemy laws, apostasy laws, etc. These are things where you find Muslims that believe in condemning those, and especially women's rights. If they can't articulate the equality of men and women, they're not people that are going to be good partners in interfaith work.
Really? Yeah. Okay. All right, I'm going to let Sudhi off. I'm going to pick on Paul. Mind? I first thought I'd say something nice about Paul. Paul came to Chicago immediately after the Bears won the Super Bowl. It was a great time to be in Chicago. So, I thank you for the heroism that the Bears brought to my community. But I do want to ask, because we've been talking how the perception of Islam denigrating the people of the book, I would ask a slightly different spin on that. Because it's also true, Judaism is the first of all these great faiths you see represented here. So it's actually not such a big question for the Jewish people who Jesus was and whether the tomb was empty. It is rather a question for the Jewish people that some in the Christian community, certainly not all, certainly not our friends, but some in the Christian community would denigrate the ability of the Jewish people to return to their land, to be a free people in their land, and to determine their own destiny in Israel. How is it that that can be squared with true Christian faith?
Thank you, Rabbi. Well, I was asked one time what kind of a Baptist I am, what kind of a Baptist preacher. And I said, I'm a Genesis 1 to Revelation 22 type of Baptist. All I believe is, thus saith the Lord. I couldn't care less about tradition. I couldn't care less about commentaries. Commentaries are just a man's opinion. I only am concerned about the Word of God. I personally believe in my understanding of Scriptures that Israel is distinct from the church. There are some Protestant denominations, and maybe some in this room, and I don't wish to offend you, but there are some going back centuries that have good grief, it's impossible to answer these questions. Okay, that have reapplied the prophecy saying that God has forsaken Israel because they're the Christ killers. So now all these promises are applying to us. And quite frankly, the existence of Israel is a slap in the face of their theology, and it's a slap in the face of their eschatology. So they want to see the nation of Israel go away. I can't speak for that group. They don't represent me. As a guy that only goes by the Bible, Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, I know good and well God's not done with the nation of Israel. And I have been to Israel 8 times as a part of other Baptists. Not a chance. Good luck. Put that. No, I'm going to stop. But I want to do what I can. The Israel belongs to the Israeli people. So.
It's interesting when I talk about what the Quran says, what the Hadith say. It's referred to as the Wahhabist version. Actually, as I've said, I've consulted 7 different translations of the Quran done by Muslim scholars, multiple Quran commentaries. When I quote or paraphrase what Allah says in the Quran, because each verse is believed to be what Allah said, if it's not, then perhaps Dr. Jasser would elucidate me on that, and we don't worry about what the Quran says anymore. The bottom line is, what I'm talking about is not Wahhabist Islam, it's not radical Islam, it's simply Islam. And that's what makes it uncomfortable for some people. Dr. Jasser talked about the verse, don't take Jews and Christians as friends. Excuse me. He said before, that means don't take them as legal advisors because they don't understand your legal or religious background. He's absolutely wrong. He's going up against 7 translations of the Quran, multiple Quran commentaries. Which simply say, don't take Jews and Christians as your friends. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. And this is one of the obstacles Dr. Jasser is up against. He wants to reinterpret this stuff, but Islamic doctrine is simply not on his side. That's the sad reality of it. I like Dr. Jasser's version of Islam much better than Muhammad's version of Islam. But unfortunately, the Muslims of the world, for the most part, follow Muhammad's version of Islam, not Dr. Jasser's.
Okay, so we're going to come back in order. We finished round 3, okay? You do need to respond to that. So we're going to let Paul Blair go.
Hoping that people forget, right?
Okay. We'll let you have the opportunity. Would you like to respond now, and then we'll skip you? Yeah, that'd be fine. That's good.
Otherwise, people are going to come along. I think, Dr. Kirby, you just proved your lack of credibility on a number of issues. The passage that says, do not take Jews and Christians as friends, the word friends is in the Arabic is what? What's the Arabic word? Awliya. So what does awliya mean in Arabic?
Well, according to the 7 different translations of the Quran.
In your Arabic studies, what does it mean? Yeah, anyways, he's going to use references of Wahhabis, Islamists, supremacists. Awliya is a legal term of legal sponsors. Your sponsor, when you have a witness in a court, is your wali. Wali is a legal representative in court. Look it up, learn classical Arabic. That's what it means. To interpret it as friends and then tell an audience that doesn't know anything or very little about Quranic scripture that that's what it is and I'm deceiving you proves that there's an agenda behind his interpretation that is not about working for reform or working with those who are your allies, but actually creating a false perception about Islam that Muslims can't fix. Because there are passages there, and the Islamists, the radicals in Saudi Arabia, intentionally misinterpreted. They actually took the opening verse of the Quran Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, and goes on and to prevent those from going astray. That's where it ends in Arabic. Many of the translations add, like the Jews and Christians went astray. And that's a Saudi-funded translation that adds these things in there and puts them in a way to deceive the West and make Muslims into fascist theocrats through interpretation. Muslims can, why can't we have a brain and use reason to modernize our faith? Why can't we have tafsir? The Quran repeatedly tells Muslims, I gave you your brain. If I wanted you to be Muslims, I could have forced you, but I didn't. I came as a warning, the Prophet tells Muslims, not as a demand. I warned you about faith, not to force these things. So there's a lot of contradictions to the black and white archaeological Islam that Dr. Kirby's portraying, and I think with a lack of credibility on some things.
Okay, I'll respond to that. Dr. Jasser talks about the Al-Fatiha, the first chapter of the Quran. And it does, the last few lines say, guide us on the straight path, which is Islam, not on the path of those with whom you're angry, nor those who've gone astray. Now, those with whom Allah is angry are the Jews, and those who've gone astray are the Christians. And I don't say that. Muhammad said it. You can look in my book, Letting Islam Be Islam. I have quite a few pages addressing Al-Fatiha, and I have the site, the sources for Muhammad saying Allah is angry with the Jews and the Christians have gone astray. So it's not what I'm saying. And Dr. Jasser keeps trying to make it sound like I'm making up what I'm saying, or this is my interpretation of this one. And I keep saying I rely on 7 translations of the Quran done by Muslim scholars and multiple tafsirs, Quran commentaries, done by Muslim scholars. I am just reporting what they say. This is not my interpretation at all. And something to think about in terms of Muslims translating the Quran, that's a pretty serious matter. It was a few years back in Afghanistan. There were some locals that decided to translate the Quran into a local language in Afghanistan. They messed up the translation. They were accused of rewriting the Quran, which is blasphemy. They were originally sentenced to death, but they ended up getting their sentences commuted to only 20 years in prison for messing up a translation of the Quran. That's why I emphasize the Qurans I'm using are translations done by Muslims. And these Muslims know it is blasphemy for them to alter anything in the Quran. So it's not what I'm saying, folks. It might not be pleasant, you might not want to hear it. This is Islam.
You're close. No, I'm not.
God is. I just want to address, what's that? I want to address Dr. Kirby very quickly, and also Dr. Jess, I have a question for him. What Dr. Kirby is saying is not only a Wahhabist kind of interpretation of the Quran, it actually goes back to many, many years of history and textbooks of Islamic teachings that has been put by multiple people who have different agendas throughout the Islamic history. And I agree with you. I was an Islamic scholar. I was teaching Islam. I was an imam. My dad is, and I have long history in Islamic teachings. And I agree with you 100%. But at the same time, I want to ask Dr. Jasser, because there is lots of people like him, and I met them, you know, as well, but he's the one who is asking or putting together an organization so they can reform Islam. So my question is, Dr. Jasser, are you going to recognize that there is history of violence and interpretation of Islam and hadith that put together on the name of Muhammad and other leaders of Islamic theology that say the same things that Dr. Kirby is saying? And what are your steps to confront those? Are you able to do anything about it? And how can we help you in this process? Because if we are not going to build allies with the Muslims who are willing to stand up, then we are not going to win this war whatsoever.
Yeah, thank you. I clearly, if you look at my work and I've studied it, I recognize that this is the major problem, are these black and white interpretations. I think Dr. Kirby actually proved my point, which is that the reason there's been very little reasoned interpretations and critical interpretations and new, renewed, modern-looking free interpretations of the Quran is because of what happens to people that try to do this. Because the societies are dictatorships that use religion as a tool to maintain dictatorship, and as thus have not had climates. There hasn't been one free society other than in the West that in which Muslims could live to ask these questions. And in the West, they've come here to escape and have not been put, and this is why I think interfaith work is so crucial, is that we need to put pressure on Muslims to modernize these ideas. But it's a big difference to say, Zuhdi, what's the problem with your history? Versus saying, Zuhdi, your religion is a recipe that's fixed in time. You really can't fix it, so I don't know what you're saying. You don't know what you're talking about. That's two different things. History does have a problem. Christianity had its same historical problems where the church was telling it that you can't do it by reason. 300 years went by when the Catholic Church prevented the laity from reading it in Latin because they wanted to control the scripture. And the reformists later said, we're going to read it ourselves and interpret it ourselves. And that's what Muslims are doing now. They've been doing it. There are so many scholars that people that want to paint Islam as monolithic refuse to look at. They're not going to pop up on your top 10 pages on Google, but I can tell you there are hundreds of reform-minded scholars that we have. I list some of them in my book. My book is not a scriptural refutation of half of the things even that he talks about, but I'm willing in any context, if you tell me what verses you're going to address, I can look them up and we can talk about whether it's the friend one, the one that says you may beat your wife. The word beat actually is strike, and just like strike can mean separate or go on strike or hit, there's different versions. So that doesn't mean beat. There's ways to interpret these things in a modern way, and the history is a problem and we're trying to address that, and there are reformists that exist, but I've either been put in jail. Raif Bedawi is a friend of mine in Saudi Arabia that I know, and he's been in jail because of these things, and the Saudis, who claim to be against the Brotherhood, have been imprisoning Muslims like me and him because they are modernizing and taking away the power from the royal families and the clerics.
I will try to speak quickly because this is to everyone. I'd like to get everybody's quick response on this. I'm going to reference two spots. First of all, Surah 9, which I think was the last surah written from Medina. Muhammad said, or the Quran says, the Christians call Christ the Son of God. That is a saying from their mouth, and this they but imitate, that what the unbelievers of old used to say, Allah's curse be on them, how they are deluded from the truth. I know Psalm 9:17 says, the wicked shall be cast into hell and all those that forget God. So, personal question to each of you guys. I know what my answer is. I'll let you guys answer. Do you believe in heaven and hell? And who goes to heaven? And does what you say, does your opinion, does it line up with the teachings of the Quran or the Old Testament? Have you tried to soften the message, or is it your opinion, or is it textual?
That's a great question. The bottom line is Muslims, anyone who tells you they know who's going to go to heaven, we say Allahu A'lam, God only knows. Bottom line, we believe the day of judgment is the day of judgment, that you will be judged for your good and the bad that you do, and that it's all recorded. There are some unpardonable sins, but nothing cannot be forgiven by God as the concept of salvation, etc. But I will tell you my personal belief. How could God tell me I could marry a Christian or a Jew and let that mother raise my children without converting and say that she's not going to go to heaven? So how that could not reconcile with a modern faith, with a sense of, and I believe there are multiple pathways to heaven, and that includes people who believe in the God of Abraham in those pathways.
There's an old tradition which has echoes in Christianity and Islam. When someone dies, all those who are completely righteous are recorded in the Book of Life. All those who are completely wicked do not get in the Book of Life. Everyone else, which is all of us, have 12 months. And during those 12 months, we have the opportunity to have purified our soul, and then we get to heaven. It is my understanding, limited as it is, of Jewish tradition, that not only did the Jews get to heaven, sorry, everybody doesn't want that, but also anyone who has conducted their affairs with integrity and honesty and are righteous enough to have sacrificed their own self-interest on behalf of someone else. So I believe that there is a strong impulse in God towards mercy, and that the arc of forgiveness will include all of us soon enough.
Well, I agree there's multiple ways of getting to heaven. I disagree with Dr. Jasser in one respect, because he said it's up to Allah. Nobody's guaranteed to get to heaven. Except for the jihadists, chapter 9, verse 111 of the Quran guarantees paradise for anybody who dies fighting in the cause of Allah. So that's why you've got these jihadists lined up to go fight and die for the sake of Allah, because they know that's their only guaranteed way to get into heaven. So keep that in mind when you're talking about these jihadists going out. Why do they kill themselves or allow themselves to be killed? In terms of going to heaven, actually, Islam teaches that Christians are going to hell because Christians believe in shirk. They believe Jesus is the Son of God, which is shirk, the one unforgivable sin in Islam. That's according to the Quran. That's according to Allah, if Allah's words are in the Quran. Allah says, that is the one sin I do not forgive. Those who commit shirk are going to hell. It's just that simple.
Is there any time for me to respond to that?
He answered this question. So now we have. Now we have one more round. But in this particular round, as I was watching closely, Rabbi Shiro, you did not get 2 minutes. Would you like to use your 2 minutes? I would like you to.
Did you ever see a rabbi I didn't want to talk? I want to bring one verse from the Quran and one historical fact, and I would like really everybody, the three of you, to respond. My limited understanding of the Quran says that in Surah 7, verse 105, that Allah promised the land of Israel to the Jews. And I would like to know if that's really so. The other thing is a historical fact. In 1922, Chaim Weizmann, the then head of the Jewish Agency, met with who was then going to be Saud, the king of Saudi Arabia, Ibn Faisal. And Faisal told Chaim Weizmann, who was going to be eventually the first president of Israel after Albert Einstein turns it down, the King Faisal says to him, he says, you take everything between the river and the sea, and we get everything else. And that actually occurred. There was an agreement in 1922 that the Jews could have an area of their own. And yet look at where we are now, when the Jews aren't even allowed 4 square feet. So I would like to hear your response, each of you, as to what you think the permanent implications are for Christianity and Islam to allow the Jews a return to their own land.
Good question. Start on the left.
Well, again, my opinion doesn't mean anything. I only go by thus saith the Lord. No, okay. I'm still bigger than you. The scriptures say that the land of Israel belongs to the Jews. It belongs biblically, and it also belongs, quite frankly, legally. You know, I think that they, from the Balfour Declaration to the San Remo Declaration, everything else, there has been several attempts at the two-state system, the separation of Transjordan from Israel, Resolution 181, Resolution 242. The reality is the Arabs reject the existence of Israel. And I don't see, I wish Zuni could make a million of him over there. Things would be a lot better. But the reality is that the political leadership over there rejects the existence of Israel. But does Israel belong to the Jews? Absolutely.
I'd ask you to read Dr. Khalil Muhammad has written a book, actually a paper about Quranic validation of the state of Israel, and I do believe there are a number of passages that refer to the people of Israel. As far as modern day Israel, my sense is, as anything in modern day, there's nothing in the Quran, and especially the issues that we agree on when it comes to the state of Israel, there's nothing in the Quran to contradict it. The Islamists who have this debate about Temple Mount and Jerusalem and other things, I think, intentionally, that's why one of the principles that Muslims sign on to join our organization is that they recognize the state of Israel. I'm almost embarrassed to include that in an Islamic reform organization, but we do because it is a litmus test. It's a red flag because of the Jewish nature and identity of Israel. It is a litmus test for anti-Semitism and others to reject the state of Israel. And I do believe that that passage is one of them, chapter 7, 105, that does validate the Quranic recognition of the people of Israel.
Yeah, I just looked at my copy of the Quran. It certainly does. The only thing to keep in mind is chapter 7 was a Meccan verse. So in terms of the doctrine of abrogation, verses revealed in Medina afterwards, if there was any conflict, the verses in Medina would take precedence over any of the Meccan verses. So I thumbed through the verse the rabbi referred to in other verses. And it's talking about Moses taking the Jews out of Egypt. But the bottom line is, when you have verses of the Quran, such as 582, that says the Jews are among the worst enemies of Islam, 551 says don't take Jews and Christians as friends, and the doctrine of abrogation simply says these verses take precedent over any verses in chapter 7, because chapter 7 was revealed in Mecca early in the period of Islam. Chapter 5 was among the last verses revealed in Medina. They take priority.
Dr. Jessen, we'll give you 30 seconds to respond.
That's all I need. This concept of abrogation exists, but who can abrogate God's word? God. There are passages, such as the drinking of alcohol, where God initially permitted us to drink. Then he said, you can drink, but stay away from alcohol during your prayers. We pray five times a day. And at the third time, he said, you know what? You've failed. I've canceled the previous permission for drinking alcohol, and you may not drink anymore, and thus we don't drink. You can't abrogate. That's what God did not abrogate. The Quran is really organized, was organized after the death of the Prophet, from longest to shortest verses. So you have to understand what order. But the Meccan and Medina verses are different because of the wars that existed and battles that existed. But to say somehow that human beings can cancel God's word just is inconsistent with rationality.
Well, I agree. Human beings can't abrogate the words of Allah. If in fact, they are the words of Allah in the Quran. But Islamic scholarship has determined the doctrine of abrogation is how you explain conflicting verses in the Quran. And the simple fact is, if a verse was revealed in Mecca, it was a nice friendly verse, and then towards the end in Medina you had verses revealed such as the verse of the sword commanding Muslims to fight against non-Muslims wherever you find them, fight against Jews and Christians until they feel subdued. The bottom line is, that's how the verses are prioritized. Abrogated Allah, Dr. Jess is right, Allah abrogated his own verses. So to me, the argument is self-evident. The verse about the Jews have a right to Israel is in a verse revealed in Mecca. You have verses revealed in Medina talking about how hateful the Jews are, how they're the worst enemies of Islam. Dr. Jasser said, Allah abrogates his own verses, and that's what happened. Seven's a nice verse. 5 and 9 were revealed later and abrogate anything in 7.
You're using a human interpretation to abrogate verses. I was telling you God directly abrogates.
Yes.
I'm just saying he's using a certain human being's interpretation to say that since those human interpretations conflict, therefore they abrogate, versus God specifically saying, I've canceled the previous verses. And this is classic. If you go into reformist modern interpretations, they will tell you nasikh or legal juridical Islam has to use a tradition, just like Talmudic law does, in looking at what came first and second to determine the law, but it doesn't cancel the scripture itself, which is the core. It's like constitutional originalists that look at the Constitution and say, well, let's interpret it, or do we just cut it out and remove the parts? And it's a big difference.
I Again, I'm sorry for interrupting again, but here is the point. What you are saying is true. What you are saying is true. Dr. Jasser, interpretation or understanding or stand is valid. He is a human being. He's making his own statement. I will believe him until proof otherwise. When if a Muslim Brotherhood sitting in front of me and telling me the stuff that he's telling me, I'm not going to believe him. Because history proves that the Islamist and the Muslim Brotherhood are lying to me. He's honestly trying his best to change what's happening or what has been referred in the Islamic teachings for years and years and years. He is clearly telling you, I believe in the existence of Israel. I believe in Israel's existence in its current borders. Islam or the Islamic teachings for years refuted that and stopped that. But at the current situation right now, we need to help him, not attack him. If his interpretation is not valid in the Islamic teachings, which is, I agree, his interpretation does not have strong followers. But we need to help him to find followers, because people like him are going to help us keep Israel safe, keep America safe, and fight this battle against Islamists. What I need to him to hear from him, instead of attacking him, is telling me, are you going to take steps to be able to put your teachings in a form of propagating into the Muslim community so you can have more followers over time, so you can build a coalition around you that will be strong enough to stop the Islamists from their teachings, and then your interpretations start becoming valid as the interpretation for 1400 years or not? Can you answer that question?
Yeah, I think that's really the ultimate question, is what is the steps to get to reform on some of these interpretations? And I would tell you, let's not reinvent the wheel. If you look at modern day Christianity and the reinterpretation of passages in many of our faiths, the environment, the laboratory that occurred in was in a free society. Until you had freedom first, you could not have the ability to have the critical thinking, the ability to leave or accept Islam, to give blasphemy speeches that were interpreted as blasphemy and say the things that are being killed for saying in Afghanistan today. Until you have that laboratory, you can't do this work. So what we need to do is, as a country, say that our number one strategy is to create a consensus in America that political Islam, the Islamic State, just like the Soviet Union was the Cold War in the 20th century, the Cold War today is against the Islamic State. Not just ISIS, but all Islamic states, even the ones that have names at the UN. We need to declare that their ideology is the evil empire of today. And then we work with the Muslims that are going to work for liberty and create a strategy. So first, Muslims separate mosque and state and be able to create governments that are based in reason and not based in the scriptural exegesis. And then from that, you can begin to foster universities and think tanks that begin to rewrite and reinterpret the interpretations that exist today for Islam. I don't think you can do it in reverse. Certainly, the power, just like our founding fathers, Thomas Paine and Jefferson, were empowered by an understanding. You can't do this from outside Islam. Lobbying, interpretations at Muslims is not going to cause us to reform. But from within, this is why working with conservative Muslims is important. The nominal Muslims that are far away from the core mainstream practices, that go to mosques, etc., are going to have a hard time reforming also. We do it from within, from a position of love and credibility within the faith. Those are the ones that are going to be able to strategize with you and create the concept of reason and a liberal state, classical liberalism, and then begin to create new mosques that are based in freedom and liberty.
We're not doing bad. I kind of anticipated that we would have a little back and forth exchange. So what we're going to do is we're going to move into our 4-minute closing statements. Okay? So we'll start first with Paul Blair.
Right here, Paul, down here.
Wherever you would like to go.
Okay. We started up here, Muslim. Get a walk to the door to leave. Well, it has been hopefully an informative evening. I hope that you all have enjoyed being here. Let me close with these remarks. I've enjoyed being here. I've thoroughly enjoyed the conversations that we've been part of today and last night. I've been to Israel 8 times.
And when I'm there, we have good relationships with the IDF and others, and we are invited on a military basis. Quite frankly, some of the rabbis don't love it, but we have permission from those that outrank them to hand out Bibles, both Old and New Testament together. We can speak freely with this man and these men, answer questions. As I teach a Bible across the country, I am free to take my Bible anywhere. I can have Bible studies anywhere from Dan to Beersheba. Doesn't matter, I'm free. Except for one spot. And that's when I go up on the Temple Mount. When we go up on the Temple Mount, we are told you can't take your Bibles, you can't pray publicly. It's not allowed up there. In fact, if you have a cross, it can't be exposed. That's not allowed up there. Well, why? Because that part of Israel is governed by the Islamic Waqf. We hear about tolerance basically from the deceivers of the Council of American Islamic Relations and ISNA and groups like that. They talk about tolerance. It doesn't exist in the 57 Islamic states. You know, I do a Google search of Saudi Arabia and try to find a GLBT organization over there. There's no tolerance. You know, get off the plane in Riyadh and start handing out gospel tracts and see what happens. There's no such thing as tolerance. You look at the history after the death of Muhammad, when Islam conquered North Africa and the Holy Land, and going up into Persia and those areas. You know, these areas, and for instance, Turkey. Turkey was at one time predominantly Grecian and Christian. Now it's 98% or maybe 99 point something percent Muslim. And what Christians are left are persecuted. Egypt, the same way. Iraq, Iran, the same way. Dr. Kirby is right in the facts that he's saying. I love Zudi. I thoroughly enjoy it, and I believe his heart's right, and I believe he is trying to reform Islam. But the Islam that Zudi is wanting to put forth is not what we've seen for 1,400 years, and it's not what's in existence in Islamic-controlled states today. So if he is successful in reforming Islam, praise God. Like I said before, I want to share my faith with anyone and everyone. I can't make someone believe it, but I can get along with everybody as long as they're not trying to kill me. So that's ultimately the goal at the end of the day. Let me just share this final comment. I can't earn heaven. I've heard a couple of my friends over here talking about good works versus bad works. God is perfect. He doesn't grade on a curve. You either grade 100% or you fall short. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It is because of God's demand for righteous judgment that debt must be paid for. Because of God's love, in spite of our sin, God provided a means of redemption, and He offers it to us freely. 4,000 years of prophecy from Genesis 3:15 all the way through the Old Testament pointed to a manger in Bethlehem, and ultimately a cross at Mount Moriah, and ultimately an empty tomb. And it is that empty tomb that separates Jesus from every other ism. Christianity is not a religion. It is a relationship with Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. I want to thank all of you for listening to my opinions and beliefs and including us in this conversation. I think that ultimately I do this work not really because of my faith. I think obviously God protects His faith, and you know, each of us is on our own, but because I'm concerned about national security. I think that both sides of the spectrum in America have it wrong. One side wants to pretend there's no problem at all and make us more isolationist and sort of let 70% of the world continue to create these pressure cookers of hate, which are going to only end up having Islamists with nuclear weapons. And the other side basically isn't giving you any solutions. It's basically saying that the recipe is wrong, and somehow 1.5 billion people are going to either vanish or become nominal Muslims or be converted. And I think ultimately, as a doctor, I treat disease. I don't have patients come into my office and just sort of tell them how bad their cancer is and I can't do anything for them and give them the address to the nearest cemetery. You know, that's not what I do. We treat disease. And if you want to solve the problem, you can anthropomorphize Islam as much as you want. But the nuances in how we do this is important. And as much as Mark, Christian, and Dr. Kirby may have been saying the same thing, and I heard them saying they agree 100%, I can tell you as a Muslim, I did not hear the same thing coming from them. Very different. The nuances in how things are said is very important. Even if you feel that there's 5% of Muslims that could be trusted, those are Muslims following the same Islam. So if you say Islam is X, Y, and Z, you're sentencing all of us and you're alienating the Muslims that could solve the problem versus saying that Muslims have a problem in their history. Muslims have to wake up and not be the silent Germans that allowed the Nazis to take over and commit the Holocaust. That is legitimate. But to say that the faith, which is God's faith, which as far as I'm concerned, you talk about Islam, you're talking about God, prevents the treatment and prevents solutions. And I hope if there's anything we learned from America, is that America figured out how to take religious diversity and make it work. Europe is actually, as much as it figured out freedom, it did not figure out religious diversity. One of my heroes is Bassam Tibi, another one of the scholars that doesn't exist, I guess, but Bassam Tibi said that secularization of Christianity actually helped Christianity succeed and make Christians closer to God so that the church did not coerce it through government, as we heard from Pastor Blair. And I think this is part of the solution. Yes, Muslims are in denial. Yes, we have not had fire under our feet and we need to do that. Yes, there's a lot of reform against Islamism, but it can be done through a love for our faith and through finding those principles that we share and share not only politically and within our countries, but also theologically. And I think it's important to note the areas of commonality and bridge building, which is what I wanted to end on. Building bridges is about finding areas in common that you want to bridge. You want to build a bridge between two things worth keeping. You don't build a bridge to something you don't want to keep. So the bottom line is if you believe you're going to have interfaith dialogue, you can't have it with Muslims if you believe that their entire faith is evil. Don't waste your time. Because that's not a bridge. That is an attempt to try to, I don't know what that is. But if it's something that you believe there may be, those Muslims that believe in the American contract and we want to figure out how they're going to do those reforms, then that's worth interfaith dialogue. But it shouldn't be apologetics. It should be reality in dealing with the problems and posing solutions. So remember that the evil leaders of the world, the Muslim mafia of the 56 countries today, are spending billions on Western networks like Al Jazeera that spent and gave it to Al Gore to buy his network, while us reformists are sitting in our garages with hardly any support because the support's either being spread by petrodollars or by apologetics to work that isn't looking at reform but simply trying to put blinders over the world to say that there's no problem and nothing to see here and move along. Thank you.
I tried to explain some of the work I've done, so I wanted to give you a few letters of a website, cjcuc.com, Center for Jewish Christian Understanding and Cooperation. I want to invite everyone here to Israel to come to our center in Efrat, outside of Bethlehem, to come and study God's Word in the land. I have, because of my work, come to understand the extremism of groups like ISNA and CARE and the Muslim Student Association. And yet I am impelled because of concern for the dear sweet lives of my children and grandchildren, to be concerned about the welfare of this country. And so it seems to me that we have to find a way out. We do not have an option. So I'd ask you to consider the following Bible story about Joseph. Joseph appears before Pharaoh, and he explains to Pharaoh his dream in the sense that 7 good years will be followed by 7 bad years, and that Pharaoh, during these good years, should find somebody, chacham v'navon, wise and with understanding, to appoint over the saving of the produce and of the grain over the good years. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe we have a short amount of time between these last 2 blood moons and the next 2 blood moons of next Passover, April 4th, and the following autumn. I believe that there will be some difficult days in Jerusalem. And we need here in Omaha to appoint somebody, Chacham v'Navon, wise and with understanding, to consult and to assist so that the efforts to bring together the faiths of all of our people in peace and in liberty and in understanding with dignity and respect for all individuals, that we might find a way to do that here in Omaha so that others might see it possible to do in the best possible way. I ask you to pray for the peace of Jerusalem.
You know, I've got to repeat again, I agree. I think Dr. Jasser's got some great ideas. And as I said before, I like Dr. Jasser's version of Islam a lot better than I like the Islam of Muhammad. But Dr. Jasser also talked about reality and trying to address the problem. And the reality is we're not dealing with the Islam of Dr. Jasser. We're dealing with the Islam of Muhammad. So we need to keep some things in mind. If the Quran consists of the words of Allah, and Muhammad spoke for Allah, then Islam was perfected during the time of Muhammad. The Quran cannot be changed. And once Allah and Muhammad have decided something, a Muslim is not allowed to disagree with them. This means the only religion acceptable to Allah is Islam. And Islam is to be supreme, reigning over all other religions, even though non-Muslims don't like it. This also means that the Jews are among the worst enemies of Islam. Allah curses the Jews and Christians and says they're among the worst of creatures. Allah forbids Muslims from being friends with Jews and Christians. Instead, Allah commands Muslims to fight those Jews and Christians until they pay the jizya, the protection money, with willing submission, feeling themselves subdued. Islam also teaches that Christianity is a false religion based on a fraud. Jews and Christians are only worth half as much as a Muslim, and Jews and Christians will take the place of Muslims in hell. Now, the Tri-Faith movement here in Omaha seeks an acceptance of various religious expressions, the promotion of mutual respect, and a coming together as a community. You could say, as they put it, by mutually crossing over bridges that might divide us. But there's another approach to bridges that I think is more applicable to Islam. And I refer to the writings of Sayyid Qutb, a Muslim Brotherhood official in Egypt, very influential. He was executed by the Egyptians in the mid-60s for plotting the assassination of, I believe it was Nasser, yeah, thank you. Qutb talked about Jahiliya, and when he talks about Jahiliya, he's referring to the non-Muslim world. And here's what Qutb had to say. The chasm between Islam and Jahiliya is great, and a bridge is not to be built across it so that the people on the two sides may mix with each other, but only so that the people of Jahiliya may come over to Islam. That, I think, explains the approach of Islam, the doctrine of Islam, to this idea of building bridges. And one thing I've got to emphasize, I talk about Islam, I don't talk about Muslims. Muslims come in all shapes and forms and sizes, degrees of their religiosity, degrees of their knowledge about Islam, but I talk about the Islam of Muhammad. So think about this. If the Quran consists of the words of Allah, and Muhammad spoke for Allah, the anti-Jewish, anti-Christian, supremacist teachings of Islam undermine the idea of an interfaith dialogue and have no place in the tri-faith movement. Thanks.